folks. Welcome back for another episode of Our Journeys. This is a special edition. It's not quite a spotlight. It is going to feature a single player from Brazil, actually. And because of a little bit of a language barrier and just not a level of comfort with conversating, we're not going to be able to give it the full spotlight treatment, but he did express an interest in doing something like a spotlight. So I said, hey, just send me some games and we'll go ahead and display those anyway. We'll showcase the games and you as a player. And I have a few little facts here and there, but let's go ahead and jump in. We're going to take a gander and we'll talk as we go. But I present to you Tiago. And here we go in 3, 2, 1, roll tape. This is the only game that starts kind of in the middle of the action. As you can see, it's probably a good thing. We are on turn 12 or beyond. I don't even know how, we could be on turn 20. We don't know, but we are beyond turn 12. I guess if there was no ramp, you know, if there was ramp, we could be beyond it. But turn 12, this is a singleton deck. And as you can probably, will be able to hear, and you can see by the Perficio, I'm not even gonna try it. That this is, it's in Portuguese. So as I said, Tiago he lives in Brazil, but Portuguese is the predominant language, and that's the language that this is. He said the translation is very faithful. And the voice acting, from the little bit that I've already heard, I haven't watched any of these games yet. But I have like heard little bits and pieces of the dialogue. So it's kind of cool. We get the, and I'm sure I'm guessing Kevin Eisenfuss, if we had gotten footage from him directly, we probably would have the same thing with it being in German, but we didn't. We weren't able to get that, or the way I recorded it. You know, I recorded from my perspective, so everything was in English. But as we have here, we're gonna hear the voice lines and everything in another language, which a lot of you probably will know just because you've memorized. Like, you know, we played these cards so much, we know what they're saying. But anyway, let's focus in on the game. Let's hone in on the game here. Tiago said he does. First of all, the last name, which I cannot pronounce. I did ask him how to pronounce it. He said, but because English, the way we pronounce our R's and everything, it would be very hard for him to phonetically pronounce for me. I thought it was Tiago, but it is Tiago. But I do know that the last name Ferreria. I don't know. I can't say it, but it means the blacksmith. So it is Tiago the blacksmith, and I will refer to him that. As such, from time to time, just because it's pretty darn cool. I mean, and it's a Portugal last name, same thing. I don't know. Anyway, oh, you see that? It's a provoke, I guess, or you know, taunt. And it's looking pretty rough. Although the siege. I gotta say, the voice acting is pretty good. Like, it can be very difficult sometimes because, you know, when you get used to hearing a certain voice actor in your mind. Heal up. Yeah, he's going off this turn. We may see a concede here. So this is a single turn. I think he said it's an 85 card single, and he's trying to work his way up to 100. It's kind of like a personal challenge, I believe. But right now it's an 85 card singleton Telvanni. He only plays control. Not a fan of aggro. Will not play aggro. So some of these games are going to be long. Some of them are pretty quick. But some of them do go on for quite some time. Oof, look at that. Every card has a purpose. Every card had a play. And we just saw him claw back from 4 points or 7 points, I think it was. And a formidable board. And now he's firmly in control, I would say. And it looks like he may be of the mindset. Yep, there we go. We got to concede from Animistic. Game number two. So I did mention, like I said, it's not my personal favorite necessarily, the attrition victory. You know, I think control is great, but I think ideally you have that moment where you pivot into the attack. It can be an OTK. You can wait till you have, you know you can do it all in one turn. But I have actually let people rope themselves when they have a full board. They have like 15 health. There's no prophecy in the world that I could possibly get to beat them. But I want them to actually have to play to win. Like, I want them to actually have to beat me. So, once they've got it locked down, I'll just leave the game. I'll go to the bathroom or go do some dishes or something. And you know what? If they want to play around and fill their board some more, then they're going to have to, you know, they're going to have to probably wait a turn with me doing absolutely nothing. Because, you know, you got to attack. But anyway, I don't know for a fact, but either way, Tiago, the blacksmith, did advise me that that some of these are really spectacular games. I believe even the last one he said is probably one of his favorites. And he is in the lady right now, rank 4, up against 6 Dovahkiin 6. I'm wondering if those are just bookmarks and it just wanted to be Dovahkiin, but also running a fellow Telvanni player. Although he is in the Atronach, the goofy, Turdish-looking Atronach. I mean, come on, we've got so many amazing Atronachs. Like, you know, your Frost Atronach, your Lava Atronach, they look so cool, but the constellation just looks goofy. It's like he's got these, like, big, goofy hands. Anyway, focusing on the game here. So we know Tiago the Blacksmith is in it for the long haul, but it also looks like Dovahkiin is also... Although he has cracked a rune, and usually once you get a control player to crack that first rune, they're done holding back. They've now shifted into the aggressor, and they're going to be coming after you. I found that out the hard way. Usually it's the hard way. Once a control deck is either provoked or decides to go face it, usually means they're fairly certain, fairly confident they're in a position to win it. Either in that turn or the next turn, and historically they're right. Hey, there's the ostensibly cute. Ooh, what a combo there from Dovahkiin. All right, so aside from having a little bit of a card disadvantage, things are looking. I mean, they're not looking fantastic for Dovahkiin, but it's certainly not. I mean, they are pushing. And Ancano, saying his thing as he does, but in Portuguese now. Or Portuguese, I think it's. And he gets the mummification treatment. As you see, Tiago the Blacksmith also has the mummify. See, it's cool. Like, sometimes my problem with some of the voiceovers in other languages, and I'm sure it's the same if you were to reverse it. Like, if you were to see a Portuguese movie that was dubbed in English or what have you. And I'll be honest, a lot of anime, aside from Dragon Ball Z, that's probably the only anime that I prefer the English to the English music and voiceover work to the original. And that's probably because I watched it in English first. But there's no other series. I really don't like English voice acting for anime. So I'm guessing it's the same for other ones. But sometimes, I mean, there's definitely there are variations or large discrepancies between quality. Sometimes it's like we're just trying to get this out the door. Another siege coming down. He does not want to duplicate his mummy there. There's the. Doesn't need the dismantle. So this one, as opposed to the last one, there we go. There is the first really helpful card at the moment. And another one. So the second round has been a lot better. And it's fantastic. And now, like I said, we were, I don't know how many turns in. I didn't look. I think it was in the middle of the lineup there. But him being able to have that siege at these points in the game is fantastic. I didn't ask him how consistent it was, though. Alright, says get rid of those mummifiers. Mummifications. Don't want you mummifying my stuffs anymore. And since Dovahkiin is not running a singleton list as Tiago, the blacksmith, is. He does not have, or he's
defeat you.
That's actually a pretty harsh blow, whereas, oof. Alright, so he's gonna take out Morikai, so unfortunately won't be able to doppelganger. I think that was the ideal next turn. Although he could Soul Tear into Morikai. And then, let's see, Morikai, that would be 12.
Read.
There we go, okay. Hey, I called one, woo! Oh yeah, no, yep, he can do it because he's got Set Smash work, so he can actually do them both. And there is a very handy, what do you call those? Doppelganger, there you go, doppelganger. Dovahkiin has now had his efforts slowed continually, and you know what? It looks like they're both gonna die, but boy, if he could play the mask, it looks like he may be able to. If he can play the mask, he can not only trade favorably, or not favorably, but he can trade with, or, I mean, either one. There he goes, another five. Sacrifice, so smart playing that. And I mean, then he can also do the mask and get him back, get himself up to 27. I mean, he really doesn't need to with what he's going for it anyway, because I think, again, like that'll allow him to make that favorable trade there. So now his health right back up again, down in the depths, and he brings it back. And Dovahkiin now, with the only advantage, I mean, and then the other, I mean, the crazy thing that I just completely forgot until I looked down, that gives him all his runes back too. So it's now almost starting from square one, but Dovahkiin is at a huge card disadvantage. Has to use the, did not want to do that, I guarantee you. Especially now when he's facing down a 7-7, that's gonna, can trade right now with two of those. I mean, Tiago the Blacksmith is not out of the woods yet, but now that he has the gray mask, I can't remember his name now. Gosh, this is where the different language is gonna mess me up, because I can't, the Gray Fox, that's his name, the Gray Fox. Now that he has him, he can make use of any card that Dovahkiin has played thus far. And he will duplicate Morikai. So we're seeing some key plays here. Look at that. Three Morikais. Well, in total, we're not playing all three. And he takes Faith's experiments. He's already got one. He now has two, by my count. Ooh, Aelid Guardian. Wondering when that was going to come out. And another one. Okay, so Dovahkiin down, but not out, as I'm very familiar with the phenomenon of the player having the one card in their hand being the most devastating. It's like it couldn't have just been a one or two drop, right? The three drop, because all of our decks, if you run a well-constructed deck, you've got a ton of two and three drops to sort out your early game. Oh no. They could erupt into, I think, was it next turn? Yeah, if he doesn't play any cards next turn. It's going to take a little time. But he does have one in the shadow lane. Ooh, and Kano, another really powerful pick or pull from Dovahkiin, getting all his late game when he needs it. Ooh, that would normally be good, but of course, as we know, those Aelid Guardians are also immune to lethal. And I would like to point out, you know, because in the lore you go, okay, if they're statues, essentially, the Guardians, and you're like, okay, so that makes them immune to lethal, the Automaton should be immune to lethal too. I thought of that the other day. I was actually trying a Centurion deck, or a deck trying to get the Centurion title. All right, so we're going to see probably Encano to blast that. Which one is he going to do? He might be trying to protect his... it's not going to make a difference. Although he will be able to ward up the 3-7 if he wants to. Huh. Interesting. Okay. Let's see what he's got up his sleeve on his mind there. Okay. It's going to allow for a surviving trade with that Guardian. And actually, he will be able to finish off the Guardian, the 8-5 Guardian, with the Viper. Okay, nope. He decides to go a different route. Okay, so he was lining them all up. In his mind, he was going, hey, I want to get them all down to 5 so that any Cruel Firebloom target is a good one. Does Dovahkiin have another? Okay, not the best card in the world, but certainly not bad. Probably going to kill off what's his name there. I can't remember his name now. Martin Septim? Is that his name? I think it's Martin Septim. I think he's going to be the target of the 5-3. Okay, there we go. Replicated. Card draw. So yeah, Tiago the Blacksmith just playing very, very well. This is somebody who plays control on the regular. Like I said, that's kind of his jam there. Also, fun fact, it was crazy. I just kind of... Let's see. Right, so we're going to see that Martin Septim die, I guess. Oof. I've never seen 2 Soul Bursts. And that Martin was not the target. Interesting. Oh, you know what? Okay. A little bit of naughtiness there. A little bit of naughtiness. Dovahkiin now seems to be a little bit out of gas. We've got 3 Martin Septims that if Tiago just doesn't play anything, yep, all 3 of them are going to go off next turn. I've never seen 3 Martin Septims, 3 Akatosh avatars manifest. This is going to be a treat here. And an OTK. Unless Dovahkiin is running Giant Snake. Which if he is... Nope. Okay. That's it. Look at that. Obrigado. Whew. Hits with the big boy. Look at that. As if they were common tiny dragons. Well fought, Tiago. So like I said, control is his jam, and he's playing it very well. 85 card. I believe 85 card. Singleton. Telvanni. Devastating. I think he got me interested because he mentioned he was able to do a... He was able to get 2 or 3 Dagoth Urs playing in one of these games. Not in one of the games that we see here, but it was a week ago or something. He's like, yeah, I was able to get 3. I was like, I just found that incredibly intriguing. I've seen in... I mean, I don't really have a chance to... I haven't had the time in a while to get to the Discord, but I do see the messages pop up from time to time, and I do see, like, images, and I'll take a quick look. Ooh, Penitus Oculatus with... One of the better steals of the early game. Able to switch over to 2-3. But it's no match. She sounds... I don't mean rough, like... Well, she does sound rough. But I guess the original one... No, I'm thinking of the Awaken. We see you waking. And so she's got the smoker's cough, smoker's vocal thing going on. And there's a target for the Snick. Territorial Viper. Biting hard. And there's another more hold. Of course, we know Tiago does not have another Viper in his deck there. But yeah, Decentennial. Decentennial? Is kind of running a little light here. Ooh, and that prophecy is a big deal. Yeah, with the Blacksmith killing off the second traitor. and at the same time spawning a bunch of zero-cost lightning bolts via Thorana, which is, that can be devastating. Because, you know, sometimes there are actions that you multiply with Thorana where it's like, okay, I don't necessarily want 5,000 of these particular actions in my deck. Lightning bolts, I mean, you do that one more time, you've got, what, 40 points of damage of zero cost floating around in your deck. Now, granted, it's an 85 card deck, so it's going to be a little harder to find them all, but that is pretty impressive. Okay, admittedly, I missed what just happened there. Okay, he did a rebirth, or not a rebirth, a soul tear. And no doubt, even though maybe he didn't want the Viper necessarily, he probably did it because he knows there's a pretty good chance that Thorana does not survive this turn. Although, I don't know, Dissentinel? It's like the saying, the Sentinel. Dissentinel. Seems very intent on hitting that phase, so I don't think Tiago had to worry about Thorana being destroyed. So in a bit of a tight spot now, the board is getting much more formidable. And that's the dream for the Pilfer side of things. Have a nice, decent sized board. Oh no, and there's the dream for Tiago the Blacksmith, who takes out the support that was the answer. And just like that, the fortunes have turned. And with a call of Rivas, gonna grab the Viper again. It seems he's saying, I don't think I'm gonna need that health. I'm gonna need a way to attack. But also, I did, so I asked Tiago if he was, well, as soon as he told me he was from Brazil, admittedly, the siege on cue. Okay, now, so he does run Sets Masterwork and he runs Mushroom Tower, so it's not a guarantee, but he has Thorana on board, so it doesn't matter. Because he cannot trigger a second siege, he now has three of them for free. And when you're running 85 cards, I mean, one of the reasons why he's running 85 cards as opposed to something, you know, the 75 card is that he expects to or wants to trigger 2, 3, 4 sieges. And, you know, you can start to run a little bit low on cards after you do enough of those, if the game runs long enough. This is definitely queued up against... that's very Nahagleave sounding. But anyway, so I only know one person. Well, I don't know them personally, but there's a gentleman named Dan Vask. Amazing singer, amazing voice, very humble guy, very fun guy. Makes fun of himself, not arrogant, but, you know, he's got the long hair. He's just, you know... the singer, he looks like somebody that should be, you know, some worldwide celebrity. Anyway, he does a lot of like metal covers of traditionally non-metal songs. Some of them are metal or have elements to it, but he does covers of it. And actually, Tiago is familiar with him. So, I mean, it sounded stupid when I said it in the email. I'm like, Brazil is not, it's not like, you know, a five-person state, like, or country. The chances that he would know another person in there who's not a huge celebrity, pretty rare. But no, he has heard of Dan Vask, so I encourage you to check out Dan Vask, D-A-N-V-A-S-C. If you really like metal music, he just does amazing covers, has an amazing voice. And as I said, Tiago is familiar with him, loves metal music himself, so he's also a big fan of him. Alright, and so I think Tiago is going, okay, I don't necessarily have a way to gain life right now. If he had Morikai, perhaps. So yeah, I guess it sounds stupid to say, but it's situational. Earlier it looked like he might not be willing to crack those runes. But maybe that was just because he was like, okay, I can heal up But he's wisely seeing that he's, you know, if the Sentinel has Tazcad or... And yeah, so that was a great pivot. A very quick and definitive pivot by on Tiago's part. And like I said, I'm a big fan of that. Big fan of seeing the writing on the wall, either seeing, okay, they're pushing, and I don't have a way to get stuff off the board if they're gonna, you know, send Cliff Racers at me. I think Ultimate Heist, if the Sentinel has it, all he needs to do is ping and play it, and Tiago would be done for. So I think just very wisely seeing the threat, knowing that he really has no way to address it, and switching to aggro mode, which I guess is not really aggro. I think aggro can only be aggro if you start with that.
Prepare-se para morrer.
Another little...
Foi uma honra.
I don't know what that means. I'm trying to remember which one. I know the last one is prepare to die. I can't remember what that one is. Maybe it's good game. I think it's good game.
Obrigado.
And that may be thank you. Alrighty. Also, another fun fact. I don't know how it came up in the email, but to express laughter in Brazil. So like you see LOL or ha ha ha. In Brazil, you express their version of ha 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 is KKKKK. I don't know if it has to be 5 Ks, but it's so I guess it's like a kind of like a chuckle. Like, I mean, I actually have a friend who legitimately laughs like that. He goes, but I think that's, and I catch myself. I don't have several hard Ks in a row, but like you kind of kick off the laughter with a So I guess mine would be K-H-E-H-E-H-E-H-E. Anywho, just thought I'd drop that trivia in there. So if you're ever talking to somebody from Brazil or somebody who speaks Portuguese and you see a series of Ks, it means that's laughter. That's their ha-ha-ha. Because really, I mean, which is kind of the same in a similar vein as English laughter. Ha-ha is more representative. Like, nobody really goes ha-ha-ha-ha-ha. I don't know anybody who laughs like that. I've not heard anybody who laughs like that. If you do laugh like that, more power to you. I just haven't heard it. I've heard some very bizarre laughs, but not one that actually would be spelled out ha ha ha. So it's the same but different. Anyway, back to the game. Rolo 1412 with a hand buff, I'm guessing. Or at least obviously a rally. Not a great deck for what we know Tiago is packing here, because unless Rolo can close this out in the next 5 turns, maybe before Siege. I think once Siege goes off, we've seen how effective it can be, and that's two crushing blows from our opponent. Just gets a discount on Siege. That's, you got to watch out for that little guy, the little 1/2. I think y'all might have remembered it. This is like, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks ago. I saw my opponent play him, and I was like, oh, that's so cute. I wonder what he discounted. And 3 turns later, Siege comes down on turn 8. I'm like, oh, okay, well, good game. Like, I'm done. She actually sounds a little, like, nicer, that cat's paw. I'm trying to remember. All I can hear, for whatever reason right now, all I can hear in my head is the Awakened Dreamer. I see you waking and sleeping. Ooh, that hurts. Cat's Paw is typically a pretty draw engine. I don't think Tiago had a way to... He's going to clear up for an Ice Storm, though, I think, right here. Kaboom. Yeah, he didn't really have a way to trigger her. I don't know if she... I don't think it counts if she gets hit by an Ice Storm. I think it has to be like a cool fire bloom or something like that. Maybe I could be wrong. I don't know if it's just if she dies by friendly fire. But Rolo keeping the pressure on with two, count them two. I don't know why I'm telling you to count them. Two charge creatures. Hannibal Travin. Yeah. and Tiago deciding that, because I think if he could have waited, if he could have played Hannibal first, then Hannibal would essentially be storing, barring being silenced, would be storing a siege. But I think Tiago, the blacksmith, correctly identified the fact that he needs. Ooh, and what a combo there! It's going to be able to take out the 3-3 and heal for 5 with that mighty sword, the. Not Dawnbreaker. That sword. The one that A-Ross often uses in his mono blue decks, or blue heavy decks, to get that little bit of life gain, unexpected life gain, that you really don't see much in Battle Mage or mono blue. That and Clockwork Dragon. Don't know if Tiago runs that. Okay, so yeah, as we see, that probably would have hit Hannibal had Tiago saved it. Almost certainly would have hit him. And we can see Rollo running. I mean, I wouldn't call it a heavy prophecy list or prophecy heavy list, but you also don't see Grotwood Ambusher, I believe that's her name. You don't really see her unless you're running a heavy, a prophecy focused list. A bit interesting. Blackhand Messenger takes out the ambusher. A little bit of irony there. She's like, aha, I drop out of the trees. I shoot you with an arrow. Ping! And Blackhand's like, hold my beer and my letter as I hit you with my drain. Fireball, light knife thing that I don't have after I throw it at you. Which I guess makes sense. I mean, why would a messenger carry around a weapon or something? But anyway, as we see, once again, Tiago staying in the mix. Like, we've seen it time and time again in all these games. He gets knocked down and then finds a way, whether it's through Morikai, the Deathless, or just through the way he plays the deck, very, very skilled, is able to bring back, bring himself back to life and stays away from the death. And wow. I don't blame the guy. The opponent, whoever it was, I would have bailed there too, probably. You just kind of see the writing on the wall against the Telvanni deck. And I don't know that Tiago runs Amulet. We haven't seen it anyway. I mean, granted, 85 cards. He may very well have it. We just don't see it. But that is another support that he probably doesn't want to clutter up. He's probably either one sets Masterwork or the Mushroom Tower. So I would be surprised if he also ran Amulet. It can be useful, obviously. I've gotten screwed over by it enough times. All right, so he has the discount card, but no siege as of yet. Might see in the next turn or two, just that seems to be the trend so far. And he's up against Stifler's mom. Ooh! Perfect! Has just the right cards on the board to enable his Oathman to get all the good stuff. And while it's not a beefy board, it's a nice one. Lots of guards. Although, again, he's up against, I keep thinking in an aggro or even mid-range sense. But there we go. There's that amulet. So we may be in for a longer match. I haven't timed any of these out. I know there's some short ones, and then there's like two or three pretty long ones. And I'm not sure if this is going to be a short one or a long one. I'm guessing, as it is against another Telvanni deck, this could be one of our longer games as both control players. But Tiago has already kind of gone on the aggressive. And I'm guessing he's going to nuke the 4-4. Because that's the only... Well, no, I'm thinking he would choose something else. Because... Oh, and if it was the 4-4... Ooh! Now that triggers, right? If I'm not mistaken, even though he was... Yeah, because now there's an action. I didn't know if he was brought into the world, if he was brought into the board by an action. All right, so let's see, what did he... That's the second time we've seen Tiago get around that 5-3 guard that is usually, you're going to lose something. I think he's managed to get around it twice now. And it really is brilliant. I mean, and there's another one. And he's got to be targeting that 2-3 with that. And he's not going to give Tiago a chance to get away from it. Okay. Probably not the target he wanted to hit. He probably wanted to get the 5-3 first. But of course he doesn't want that Now, little did he know, though, that Tiago did not have an action, so an item to play, so he would not have been able to trigger that. But considering the, it's not an atromancer, whatever that thing is, it was going to spit out another 5/5 guard. Siffler's mom did not want to take any chances. Siffler's mom also in the lady. Okay. There's nothing wrong with it. I'm stating it as is. It just sounds a little weird. So, amongst the constellation that appears as a lady.
Sinto grande poder em você.
So the cruel fire bloom has to be the call here. He's going to have to sacrifice her. Okay. Well done. So this was not one of the long ones. Obviously. Man. Tiago just moving through him. I'm fairly certain. I don't want to take any of the tension out, but I'm getting the vibe that we're not going to see a loss here, because this was not just, hey, send me, you know, all the games you played on this day. It was like, he was like, hey, I'll send you some games if you like. I was like, go ahead and send me which one. All right, so he has Siege in hand already. But if, I mean, we could tell by the imp that this is probably going to be your hard-nosed aggro warrior deck that we're used to seeing. And so this may be the biggest challenge to Tiago's. Oh, maybe not. That's not a typical, it's not a bad card to play. It can chop through guards and things of that nature. But maybe it's not as hard-nosed as I once thought. And by once thought, I mean seconds ago.
Okay.
Tiago does have the sanctuary pet to shackle down the recently transformed werewolf. And Ungrom, proving to be a very disappointing... I mean, you know, it's not worthless. So is he going to hit him with the black hand? Okay, he's going to take away lethal, leaving the 4/3 on the board. Does have the sanctuary pet. Maybe going, hey, knock out another rune, give me a few more cards here. Okay. Eisen Spiegel. So wait. So Eisen Foss meant Iron Fist. So Eisen Spiegel means Iron... Spiegel. I don't know what that is. I don't know what Spiegel is. But in any case, Eisen Spiegel is running a very bizarre list here. Oh, he's got the nice Shadow Fen and uses it. I was going to say effectively, I mean, if he had Tiago down to, you know, 10 health or less, that would be a pretty... important play, but right now he's not doing well as the aggressor. He is not doing well enough to really put the hurting on Tiago. That said, all it takes is one good swing with a 5-power creature and the Sword of Revenge to be in a bad spot. Very fortunate that he got that extra little bit from Martin Septim that allowed him to whip out that Encanto a turn early. Otherwise, we could have seen 10 damage going to face. I don't think he had a way to get around it now. Okay. All right, this is... Well, no, we... Ooh. An interesting call there. Yes, I agree. That actually sounds really cool. Like, if you just think about, like just the idea that we wouldn't necessarily understand a language from, like, Oblivion. Like, they wouldn't speak English. I think it sounds much more dire. But, well, this is the closest we've seen to Tiago on death's doorstep. His only saving grace right now Eisen Spiegel is... He's got enough magic that he could play a Wood Orc Headhunter and, you know, another Orc. So Tiago really gonna need to find a way to get that drain. To get some health back. It's always nerve-wracking when your opponent starts building up an army there. Okay. Cruel Fire Bloom isn't going to get it done. I guess it would now. And you can use it on the Black-Handed Messenger. Yeah. Oh, no, no, no. Reconsiders. Okay, so he's... Oof. Yeah. Gonna go ahead and get that 2 damage. Does break a rune. Gives Aizen another card. Okay, yeah, and say, okay, yeah, I should have... Because he killed the creature before destroying the support. So a slight misplay there, but one of the very few that we've seen, or at least that I've seen. He gave that support one last trigger before taking it out. I think that's a common... Okay, now I think he's checking to see what he might want to bring back with Mana Marco. Unfortunately for him, it looks like, other than his Shadowfen... Ooh. Shadowfen might be... That's exact lethal here, so... Okay, he needs... Okay, so does he have a charge creature? Doesn't look like it. There you go. That's a timely shackle, so unless Aizen has... Well, even if he has Unstoppable Rage right now, as it stands, it's not going to do any good. If he poked face first, he could have completely wiped him out, but maybe he has something else in mind. No? Okay. You see, he could have... Oh, no, wait, he was on zero. He didn't have the Magical, so he had either had to play it then or not play it at all that turn.
Estamos prontos para lutar.
Uh-huh.
Farei o possível.
Okay, really protecting... Well, we know he's got... He's got the... Ooh, boy. Ooh, this is tense. It's a lot of threats. Obviously, his Leaf Lurker can take out the biggest threat. He very fortunate, draws into the Snake Tooth Necklace he can give to his... is now going to have to hit face, but all the points. Right now, no big threats in waiting, and just like that, almost brought the score to a tie. Eisenspiegel with only 6 on board, needs 7. I haven't seen that many orcs, or really any orcs, to be honest, so I don't think he has to worry about the headhunter. Could have the assassin, 4-1, 5 cost. Aside from that, no, this is just a pure. So unless he's buffing up, but it's not even like he doesn't have like the Redoran Forerunner. So it's a very interesting buffer deck. And wow, okay, I officially have no idea what Eisenspiegel is running. Still, he did get Tiago as close as he's come to the brink of extinction. And it is not over yet by far. Unfortunately for him, really,
Spiegel hasn't played anything.
Now, we do know he runs Shadowfen, so that guard... well, yeah. And probably want to play that assassin down just to make sure, because that really could close out the game. Ooh, thought it would go in the field lane. Because if Eisenbeagle puts down another guard, like, I was thinking he'd want to... But I guess... Yeah, no, Travin can trade with a 2-1, take the ward off. Or if Eisenspiegel foolishly keeps the 2-1 on the board, that's 11 points of breakthrough. And he lays it down. Does not have it. We might just see a concession. This is... Okay, I guess he's good. Well, I mean, it helps. Okay, no, he's just...
Bela jogada.
I I think that, yeah, that must mean I'm done. I'm finished. Yeah, like I said, folks, I mean, you know, you play the game the way you want to, but, you know, when you got the win, it's always good just to finish it off. Some people, there are some gamers, I think, that whether it's historically done that way or not, where they're just kind of like, let me show you what I could do, or let me play out my hand, or what have you, but my philosophy is always, you know, if I get the win, you know, I'm going to let you go. Like, I'm not gonna belabor the point. Just something to think about. Just something to think about. I mean, we all know how salty we can get sometimes at the end of a loss, and to kind of have that rubbed in, you're like, just finish the game. Just finish the game. But again, as we saw, Tiago battling back from what was a very close game there. I think he was down to 3 health at one point. He was able to stabilize and turn it around. Ruby Throne, there's something you don't see every day. Actually, you don't see often at all. And there's a reason for it. It's only good for a limited time only. I think it's very hard to make it work. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, one of the key things with it, the fact that the benefit can switch to your opponent if they play a unique legendary, I think that's what makes it the most, more liability. And as we can see, Tiago with 2 unique legendaries in hand that could certainly steal the crown from the mighty Galen. Or Galen. Free rapid shot. Alright, so it looks like... Oh, nope. That's right. Forgot the ruby... The crown bestows +1/+1 at the start of the turn, so he survives that. And I'm guessing we're going to see Barbas as a guard, trying to keep Galen alive. Okay, so he gains +1/+1 at the... No, it is... Okay, it's at the start of the... No, at the start and the end of the turn? Is that what happens? I don't think I've ever noticed or really paid attention. Ooh, Ruby Throne goes away. Does it take... Okay, it does not take the crown off of... Fancy bit of work there. Ooh, Wrath of Sithis. Creepy card. Do not like seeing that card. I mean, not because of its effect. I thought it... Oh, Poopstone! No! Oh, man, how many games did we go without seeing Poopstone? A good long while, it felt like. But unfortunately, Charlie Altman felt the need to bring in some more RNG to help... Shore him up, but we see Tiago, the blacksmith, holding on to that discounted, well, not discounted, I guess. Well, yeah, I mean, right now it's discounted. Sets Masterwork. Was this a workshop deck, too? Gets Drain. That's not me, right? I can't affect this. No, the video's not live. Darn it, Tiago, get that list off of the screen. So those little things you got to think of when you're recording. As I'm sure Denise will tell you, there's plenty of things. It's like, okay, I can't really talk, I can't do this, I can't do that. I mean, you can, but you just make, whoa, my goodness gracious. And apparently that's the Galen's target. And yeah, that, the consistency of the draw is phenomenal. Rare is it? Rare is the occasion, truly, when Galen does not immediately summon forth his target. We'll see if number 2 comes down in the next turn or two. We'll be watching. Grabs himself. I wonder if that throws off the math, like if that... No, I don't think it matters what's in the discount pile. I think once the effects have been triggered, it's just, oh, Taz Daddy comes down with Drain. Oh, punished. That's a heck of a prophecy to get for Tazcat. Gets rid of the beefy guy, and he can't be brought back. And you don't have to worry about that 4-4. And hey, Tiago, cheers. Seeing Nakreem? Can't remember what his name is, but you don't see him. Apparently, he was good at one point. Maybe in beta or something. I remember Justin Larson talking about him. Apparently, he was... I don't remember what the nerf was. I don't know if he went down in stats or if it was... I don't remember. But apparently, he was good. And then he wasn't. And he hasn't been ever since. Which sucks, because I think... I don't know. I feel like there's got to be a way when you balance cards, when you nerf them or you buff them, to do it in a way that they don't become either abused or under, like, not played at all. And I think initially, I'm not sure if it was everybody. Ooh, all the magic in the world. What is he gonna do with it? He's got siege. He's got well, he can't do siege and experiments. Yes, Thornish Mage. Yes. What was I saying? Something amazing. Something brilliant. You were hanging on my word, I know. Like, oh my gosh. I mean, the game is cool, yes, but you were saying something so amazing. Kidding, of course. Fortunately, there is a game being played here, a very good game, that is infinitely more entertaining than whatever it was. And there you go. Poopstone showing why I call it the Poopstone. Nothing makes it easier to root against your opponent than them playing a Poopstone. Jeez. I mean, granted, if I was playing against said opponent, I would... Oh, is he gonna... Nope, okay. And because I guess he's about to die, so he's gonna get Gray Fox. That's a very smart heads-up play by Tiago. I thought he might have tried to grab Cicero to get more card draw, but he's going, nope, I want another Gray Fox. Yoink. Okay, and there he is going to get it on Cicero. And Charlie Altman has no idea, of course, what these replicas are going to... Oh my gosh! And once again, the experiments. Look at that. Another little 1-1 Cicero. See, and the voice quality, you know, I wouldn't be surprised, and I think because the lines are so short, I honestly think Bethesda, I don't know if they did this or not, or whoever the devs were, when they did the foreign translations, try to get the original voice actors back. Because voice actors, I mean, that's what they do. They work with their voice. They try to mimic things. Everything is in that voice. So I would imagine if you could say, like, here's how you... Oh, Oda Ving just wiping out all the goodness. All those nice little 1-1s that Tiago, the blacksmith, had put down. And, of course, gets drained, so he is up at a bazillion life right now. Yanks the ruby throne back. Not sure if that's... But anyway, like, get those voice actors and say, okay, here's a native speaker saying this line. Just mimic that with your voice. Like, use your accent or whatever it is you used in the game for the English voiceover. And just use that with the, with the translation. I think that would give you the best results. And it sounds like there are certain cards where I'm hearing them going, that sounds very much like the original. Like, they didn't try to interpret it a certain way. They didn't. And he knows, Tiago knows very, very well just how easily Septim can go off. I think that's his name. Boy, I'm going to feel silly if I didn't. But if that's not it. Yeah, Oda Ving is... Ooh, Lynette. What will you fetch, sir? He's got a whole lot of... Let's see, what has he got? 44, 16, 68? 68 cards to pick from. Haskell's in there too, huh? I crafted that guy, or I dusted that guy as soon as I got him. But I remember, was it Matt Oblivion? He used to play him a lot. He could have silenced anything, but I don't think he really cares so much about the health. Okay, he's got Manamarco's. Gotta be careful. He has to know that. There we go. He had Odavang taken care of. And no Morikai just yet. He does have the brilliant experience, or the Dark Rebirth, so he can get two more runes. Ooh!
I'm killing you.
Interesting pick there. And hi, Hrothgar. Wow, what a motley assortment of supports there. Bringing it back, he's gonna get another rune, get him up to. What is it? Well, that get him up to 24, I guess. And gets the random Crusader's Assault from his Speaker Telvanni, Speaker Telvas. Speaker Tyrannus, that's it, Speaker Tyrannus. Is he gonna play his Sails through Storms, Swims in Ponds, Paddles through Puddles, I don't remember what it's called. Swims in Sun? Basks in sun, tans in sun, tan lines in sun. I don't remember. I apologize to any Argonians out there. The names are just very. Well, it's the first time I can think that a name is actually. Most of them are verbs. Yeah. Lots of verby names for the Argonians. Alright, so this. Was this the. I'm not going to look ahead. This might be, because I remember there was one game that was like almost 30 minutes long. This might be that one. Because with, now, Tiago does have Dismantle. Out of those three, I mean, obviously I want Poopstone gone. But if this does become a drag-out game, the Nightmother could be an issue. So I think that could be why Tiago's holding onto it. He might be waiting to see if, like, we'll see if he checks out how many cards the Alright, she's gonna do gain health and big body, not wanting to do any damage to his opponent. You don't very well, just kidding, he's gonna do some damage, although it's at 7. Is he gonna break a rune? He needs to do 3 damage. He will break a rune doing this. Oh no, he won't. He's already broken the first one. Okay, now he's got another support removal, so. Poopstone! Get the Poopstone out of there, man! Come on, Poopstone! 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 Yes! Woo! Tiago, the blacksmith! Taking out Poopstone! I am a little surprised it was. Oh, there we go, okay. Very wise, knew he could do all three, and just like that, Charlie Altman is without any of his, and Tiago, in a bit of irony, now has three of his supports, one of them being one that Charlie Altman started with. Okay, he's gonna gamble. It succeeds. I've never seen that animation before. That was fun. I've thought about playing him, because it really is, it's a nice hand buff. If you guess right, I think he gives +1/+1 to every card in your hand. So it's not a bad card, especially if you're going for a hand buff deck, but you gotta take a guess. And I don't think the game makes it easy. I haven't played too many of those. Because I think Stealer of Dreams does the same thing or something. The few times I remember, I've got it wrong like at least 50 to 60% of the time. Most of the time I'm wrong. So it's not something obvious. It's like, okay, they could be playing both these. In fact, they probably run both these cards, but you have to guess the one that they happen to have in their hand, which is much harder to do. Alright, Parthenex has joined the fray. Not surprised to see him in a 85-card singleton deck. Because he's running Soul Tears anyway. So, I mean, not that you're really looking to spam Soul Tears, but... Brings back bigger tears. Or, in Portuguese, Orador Terranus. That was probably horrible. I apologize in advance. And just so you all know, PSA, what Tiago did, you all can do as well. I sent him the Dropbox link. I don't think he ended up using it. I think there was probably some communication, Dropbox issue there. But he did actually send me videos through Dropbox somehow. I'm not sure it wasn't through my link. It was through something else. He sent me that. Sent me the games. And then he sent me one through Google Drive. So that's a possibility too. If you have Google Drive, you can just link them there. I think these games were all under a gig in size. So just so you know, like if you want to have your game showcased, but you don't necessarily want to spotlight or don't want to do that, more than happy to do this for anybody else as well. Obviously, I talked about a lot of stuff that didn't have to do with the game, but you know, I do that anyway because you're watching the game. So direct commentary isn't absolutely necessary. If this was a radio broadcast, yeah, then I would be the worst commentator ever. You'd be like, I got like a tenth of what was going on in the game. The rest of the time he was flapping his gums about this, that, and the other. Alright, so Tiago, State of Affairs here, with all his runes, a really handsome board. Charlie Altman, so he's just kind of wearing him down. These kind of control games, I never want to play one of these, but these are fun to watch. Because it's not like it, their strategy, and like he knows that. Well, so Charlie has Siege, but was he Singleton as well? I don't think so. But maybe he was. I guess we'll see next turn. I'm guessing he'll play it next turn. I admit I was not paying attention to how he got Siege. I don't know if he got it on purpose or not, but it doesn't matter. Tiago looks like he is going for the throat here. And it was against a fellow Singleton. So Charlie Altman also running a Singleton deck of a completely different constitution and composition, I should say. There's his set's masterwork. Coming a little bit late. He needs a Morikai of his own to stand a chance. Not going to do it. I mean, it's kind of cool seeing it go off. Okay, that... Tiago's got two... Whoa! Okay, that's... Okay! He made a game of it on this last turn. Toronto's going to be able to push an extra five. Does Tiago have a way to finish it up at the moment? Is he going to use that on Lyneth? Get a lightning bolt, perhaps? No, sir, nothing so pedestrian for Tiago the Blacksmith. He is going to tyrannify. This is one of the few times. I think there was one game I played where it was like my what's his face? Razzmadazzm stole a siege. So if you're not playing Singleton, it's a dead card. It's an awesome card if you're Singleton, if you're not. So it's interesting to see how, you know, them trading hands. But Tiago definitely has control of this game at this point. And this long battle back and forth, to and fro, between him and Charlie Altman is about to draw to a conclusion. Draw to an end. I'm trying to think if he could shackle a whole lane. But whoa, goodness gracious, that's a big fella. I mean, it's not enough. He has enough in both lanes. He pulls it off. But he also still has non-magical. We'll see if he plays any guards. He does not. He's got some big... Except I think... Yep, Intimidate. Certas coisas não podem ser delegadas. Prepare-se para morrer! Okay. Well, yeah, no, but he's got the intimidate. I was gonna say, well, that kind of does it, but no, he. All right. You know, sometimes you're having fun, you just don't want the game to end. I'm on a mission like that. I hate to say it, but I'm the kind of person like if I'm climbing the ladder or something, I want the game done ASAP. And so as soon as I got lethal, I'm doing it, because I just, especially if the game went on for this long. But Tiago's gonna get a few more plays in here before really fill up the board, make it majestic before finishing off Charlie Altman, who may very well be thinking, mistakenly of course. Now this would be okay. This would be interesting if Tiago does not use Intimidate and kind of makes it look like, you know, he just got lethal by triggering all these sieges. That'd be pretty cool. But I have a feeling. Nope. He's gonna do it. Okay. So yeah. No. Oh. All the. Yeah. There you go. There you go. Just. Yep. There you go. Nicely done, Tiago. Nicely done. Tiago the Blacksmith with an epic victory over a singleton mirror match, and that is going to bring these games to a close. Tiago the Blacksmith, I salute you. Thank you so much for sending these to me. Hopefully, all of you singleton and control fans were able to get a nice fix here. I know I've said it many times, we don't really get enough. A lot of the folks that I watch, that I play, they're typically, I think, mid-range is the most common deck we really see. Some folks I know play some hard-nosed aggro. A lot of times, they try mid-range, they try something creative and fun, and then the ladder kicks the crap out of them because the ladder's all playing optimized stuff, and they go, okay, fine, I'm just going to do some aggro. And, you know, you get aggro Dagoth, aggro Guildsworn, and things of that nature, but not as many folks. I think Mark is probably the only one I know on the regular that does. Well, no, Mark and Rising Frequency. Frequency Rising. Oh my gosh, I'm completely blank. Frequency Rising. Yes, Frequency Rising. They play control decks, but not a lot of other folks necessarily. So anyway, I was very excited to be able to bring this to you all. It's fun to watch. Holy cow, just seeing those swings going down from that, you know, so low in health to overcoming and ultimately winning with a singleton deck, no less. And like I said, and the other thing to note too, is that Tiago's complexion is incomplete. He said he's building, he's trying to reconstruct, he's bummed that the game is in the state that it's in, that it's not being developed anymore, but he's excited to play, he loves the game, and he has built this deck that you saw there with an incomplete list. So as he builds his collection, you know, he's looking to develop it further, and like I said, I think his goal is to get to that 100 card and make that 100 card singleton effective and consistent, which is a heck of a challenge. But from what I've seen, if there's anybody who can pull it off, he can. Just some great plays there, great control, a fine display. So thank you all very much for watching this focus video. I'm not sure if I'll change the thumbnail to be something a little different. I'll just put focus in there somewhere, but it was a good time. I enjoyed it. It's a lot easier for me too. I don't have to wait for the games to queue up. I just put them all together, make a short video for me to watch, and then I can crank it out. So it's definitely good for me as well. So thank you all so much for watching, and until next time, keep playing.